Jeremiah chapter 3 and 2 Timothy chapter number 2. We're going to start in those two passages. By the way, I appreciate Alex making the announcement. I don't think I could make an announcement about the ladies' meeting with Tommy speaking about the older ladies. I have the feeling that would get me in trouble for doing that. Alex is a little younger and a little spryer than I am. So anyway, next week, you ladies, it's a great time to come. And it doesn't have to just be the older ladies that come to hear a message about them. You younger ladies can come too, because you younger ladies one day will be an older lady. And it's nice to know what you're shooting for. So it's a great opportunity to learn and be instructed. Book of Jeremiah chapter 3 and 2 Timothy chapter 2, two passages I want to look at. We've been looking over the last few months, actually, about some of the issues of the of basics in the grace life, the grace walk. And I called it R12 because we were focusing on Romans chapter number 12 and the life that is there, the grace life that's there in Romans chapter 12. And my goal in all of this has been to point you toward the life that God gives you in Christ, and it's delineated for you in detail in Romans chapter number 12. And I just want you to be mature. I want you to grow up in Christ and be a strong, mature believer, able to deal with life the way God designs it to be dealt with. And, you know, in Paul, he talks about you drink milk and then you move to meat. And that's an illustration. Hebrews chapter 5 talks about if you use milk, it's because you're unskillful in the word of righteousness, because you're a baby. Strong meat belongs to them who are full age, who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. A mature believer who gets off the milk and onto the meat, becomes a carnivore, as it were, that's an adult. But you never quit growing as an adult. You know, you look forward to, you young people, you look forward to becoming an adult. I remember when I was talking to a fellow recently. We were just out west. And by the way, the wedding went real well. And Mike and Lissette are back, and I guess they'll recover. But it was Emma and Elliot's wedding was real nice, and the opportunity there. We had the Bible conference week before that in Oregon. And all those, it's wonderful to see those kind of things. And I was talking to a young man. He says, you know, when I turned 18, my dad told me this with his home. When he turned 18, he went to his graduation from high school, and when he came home, his suitcase was on the porch, packed. And he was supposed to leave home. There were 9 of them, and he was the next to the last one. And his mother was ready to, you know, move out, go to work, get out. When he was two months after he graduated high school, he was in North Carolina. I have had a picture of him. It was in North Carolina in Charlotte in the school to become a merchant marine. And in the Depression, it's an opportunity what people did. When you turn 18 now, you know, hopefully you get out of high school. And then you think the future, college or work or whatever it's going to be. And it's that sort of that milestone. And you think, I've arrived. And then you realize, oh, man. Mom and Dad's not going to buy groceries anymore. I'm going to have to pay rent. Got a car bill, insurance, and you think maybe I'll go back to high school, or maybe an adult isn't all I thought it was going to be. And then you grow up a little bit, and you get a little older. And then you top that 30 mark. Whoa! I remember turning 30. It was a long time ago, but I remember it. Thinking, man, I got a wife and 3 kids, and look at life. Oh boy, how'd I get into this? And as you, then you turn 40, and you turn 50, and you keep, maturity doesn't start, or doesn't stop when you become an adult. That's my point. You continue to grow, and constantly growing and developing. And as a pastor, that's what I desire for you, is the capacity to be able to grow up, make adult decisions, not act like a baby all the time, not act like a spoiled brat, but to become an adult and become responsible and be able to make decisions based on understanding who you are in Christ and the outworking of the way of wisdom in your life. And for you and me, the idea of maturity is the ability to take the details of your life and to think them through and make decisions based upon an understanding of who God's given you in Christ and the wisdom that God gives you through His Word. And as you walk in those kind of things, you begin to live in those kind of things, respond in those kind of things, that's the goal of the grace life. is for your mind to be renewed and to think the way God thinks about it, and then for you to understand that and then take the details of your life and apply it. I said to you a few weeks ago, I'm your pastor. I'm not a counselor. And when I said that, I thought, that maybe didn't sound exactly right, because depending on what you think those words mean. And somebody asked me afterwards, are you sure you're not our counselor? What I meant by that is I'm a pastor. My heart is to be your pastor. I don't want to be the one who tells you what to do in the details of your life. I want to train you with understanding of the way of wisdom so that you have the capacity to then take that wisdom and make the decisions in your life that are appropriate for your life. I can't do that for you. I don't want to do that for you. I'm not going to do that for you, because I'm not going to be responsible for you. Okay? You're not. My responsibility is to teach you God's Word, to equip you with some understanding that you can then apply to the details of your life. And that's the privilege of you as a believer and as an adult. A lot of religious institutions, a lot of churches, a lot of Bible churches, you're just under the control of the leadership. You're just a bunch of little babies, and they're running things, pulling the strings, telling you what to do. I don't want that for you. I want you to be able to be a mature believer, come stand right next to me in the work of the ministry, and think about the ministry in your life on your own. Jeremiah chapter 3. This is a verse of scripture that when I first started preaching, and I understand dispensationally, a lot of folks don't like to use the term pastor, because it's, you know, in scriptures mainly applies to the nation Israel. Is used that way, only one time in Paul's epistles. I understand all that. And the idea of a pastor is a shepherd, a leader, an overseer, and so forth. But there's a verse back here in Jeremiah chapter 3 that always, from my youngest ministry, struck my heart. Jeremiah 3, verse 15. The context is about Israel. It's about the restoration of Israel and so forth, about Israel coming to understand what God's doing with them. But just take the application. Jeremiah 3, 15. I will give you, that's Jehovah talking to Israel, I will give you pastors according to mine heart. Now that's what I would want to be, is a pastor according to God's heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. My job as a pastor is to feed you the Word of God, feed you the spiritual nourishment and enrichment of the milk to the meat of Scripture, so that you would have knowledge, understand what God said, and have understanding. Knowledge is you know things. Understanding is how to take what you know and apply it to the details of your life. So my goal, come with me to 2 Timothy chapter 2, my goal is to do just that. It's not to run a religious organization. It's not to dictate what you have to do or can't do. It's not to police your life. It's to give you some understanding so that you then can go live in the details of your life off the basis of wisdom, not thinking what is acceptable to some group, but what does God say? 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 24. We just had a conference in California, in Oregon, studying through 2 Timothy. And to understand the pastoral epistles, these epistles written to pastors, Timothy, Titus, and Philemon, about the operation of the local church. You have Romans to Philemon, Paul's epistles. You have 9 church epistles, Romans to 2 Thessalonians, written to local churches about the ministry in the local church and about the doctrine. Then he has these pastoral epistles at the end that talk about the operating of the local church. 1 Timothy, you have the church in rule. Here's how it's to be organized and function, the officers and so forth. 2 Timothy, you have the church in ruin. In 1 Timothy, it says, some have departed. In 2 Timothy, all they that age have forsaken me. And every chapter in 2 Timothy talks about the declension, people departing from the truth and from the ministry of God's Word, rightly divided. And you would think with the church in ruin, that'd be it. But then you got two more. You got Titus. 2 Timothy is the last book in the New Testament written. But he doesn't put it last, because there's a spiritual design. There's a church in rule, then it's in ruin. And then in Titus, you see the remnant of the church. Here's what the church, when the church is in, the church itself is in ruin and apostasy, what do? That's Titus. You set things in order. And so you have the remnant church, and then in Philemon you have what I would call the representative church. If you want to see a fully functioning body of believers working together, Philemon is at the end. And all the stuff you've learned, here it is. Look at it. Put them on display. So when you're in 2 Timothy, Paul's combating the declension, the ruin, and he sets a pattern here about what ministry is to be about. 2 Timothy, by the way, somebody asked her, said, why do you use, they noticed me using my cell phone at the beginning. I do that to turn my hearing aids down. I don't want to hear myself talk quite so loud, okay? That's why I did that. And I listened to John sing, and I said, maybe I should turn them off. But but I resist that. 2 Timothy 2, verse 24. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves. If God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. You know Satan has a will for your life? And his desire is to hold you captive by some bad doctrine, by some bad thinking, by some improper understandings, so that he holds you in his clutches, he holds you captive, and you're not able to function in the liberty that God gives you in his Son. The counterbalance to that is the servant of God must not strive. If there's anything that would rebuke a pastor, a teacher, a leader, is that. Much striving, arguing, contention, striving. Only by pride comes contention, that lifting up of self. And he says, that's no place in the work of the ministry. But what do? You be gentle. That means you're not beating people over the head all the time. Gentle unto all men, apt to teach, able to teach some sound doctrine. You're not here to entertain. You're not here to grow a big organization, get a big following. You're here to teach some people some truth out of God's Word that then can live in them. Patient. It's going to take a while. He assumes you're hard-headed. Patient. In meekness. He assumes you're going to rebel against some of it. Instructing. The only way you're going to get past all of that emotional stuff is by teaching the truth. Teaching the truth. Not putting up a list of rules and regulations, just teaching God's grace. And the goal is instructing those who oppose themselves. Believers that are acting like they aren't believers. We studied that issue about reversionism, where you revert back. You're saved, but you revert back in your thinking into the old man. Instructing those who oppose themselves. So to get repentance. Now, we studied through those issues there as we were talking about these things. But my job isn't to rail on you. It's to be patient with you. It's to teach you. It's to have long-suffering kindness. It's to protect you, help you to recover yourself from things, to equip you with the wisdom and the maturity and the encouragement and the tools to grow so that you can function in your life and in the work of the ministry. I want you to be able to choose to know Him, to understand God's grace, and to go all in for grace. You know, we were watching a football game yesterday. My wife loves Alabama football, Roll Tide. And they were playing a ball game yesterday, so last night we're in the family room there, and she's doing some things, cleaning up clothes and stuff from the trip. But just listening to this ball game in the background. And the first quarter, they weren't doing so good. In fact, the first half, they weren't doing so good. And there came a point where their coach, in essence, he got mad. You ever get mad? And it was the commentators are watching and says, whoa, the coach is mad. Look at him. He's chewing the players out. Then he's chewing the coaches out in the box up top. He was chewing everybody out. His face as red as his shirt was. And then the team got better. They started winning, and they got their act together. And so they ask him at halftime, he says, well, what was it that turned things around? And he looked at the commentator and said, did you see me get on them? Oh, yeah, we saw that. He said, maybe you answered your own question. And he walked off. And I thought, well, that kind of made sense because it worked, kind of a thing. All he wanted them to do is go be all in. Let's play the game. Let's be all in for this. Let's don't just be here. Let's just don't listen to the cowbells ringing and get a, let's focus on who we are and what we're doing and go all in and play football. I want you to do, I don't care anything about football. I care that my wife likes it. I like it when she likes it. When she doesn't like it, we watch something else. We turn the TV off, actually. But I want you to be all in. Now, Mike's back there. He's grinning because he, did y'all win yesterday? Oh, see, he's happy today. It, for him, it's a strange thing. So, anyway, the idea is just give yourself to it. Relax. And I've tried to talk to you as your pastor. Not somebody trying to manipulate you, but just here's the, some things that you need to get a hold of. And as I've talked with you about it, I'm conscious in the back of my mind that the greatest challenge in the world out there to the doctrine of grace, to the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the Word of God, the greatest challenge in the minds of the world is suffering. Some years ago, Barner did a survey. And you know who Barner is, the pollster. He did a survey, and he asked a question. And the question was, if you could ask God one question, what would it be? The top question, by a great majority, was the simple question, why is there so much pain and suffering in the world? And why don't you do something about it? Well, that's two questions. But it's all in the first question. Why is there so much hardship, poverty, hunger, pain, suffering, abuse, cruelty in the world? If you're God, if you're all-powerful, why don't you stop it? If you're a loving God, if you're a good God, how do you let those horrors go on? Why don't you care? Why don't you do something to help? And the world looks at God, the idea of God. You know, the pagans say there are multiple gods, all equal. So they can say one God is good and one God's bad. When bad happens, the bad God got you. When the good things happen, the good God got you. But the Bible says there's only one God. So you can't have a bad God and a good God. You only have one God, and he says he's good. Then why do the bad things happen? And that question, there are atheists that propagate their atheism based on that argument. The argument they give is casually answered, is viciously answered, asked, and never more than just flippantly answered. But that question about suffering, hardship, difficulties, pain, and you look at the misery in the world, and you say, well, where's God in all this? Listen, in your life, you're going to be at a place, if you haven't yet, hang on, it's coming, I'll warn you. So when it shows up, it doesn't shock you like, where did this come from? You're going to have times in your life when you look at what's going on, you look at the wall, and you say, where's God in this? If I'm a believer, if God's good, how could this happen in my life? And it's going to be like you're talking to the ceiling. And there's not going to be a big epiphany that comes. And you're going to face that question. And the answer to it's God's grace. The grace of God is the answer to all of the crosswork of Jesus Christ is the answer to all of that. God is all-powerful. He is loving. He is good. And we looked at the issue of depression. Because when you go through that kind of event in your life, it won't be long before you're depressed. Because there's the silent heavens. Sir Robert Anderson wrote a book, The Silence of God. That's when God doesn't answer. Now, you see, you run into religious stuff. You say, well, God, he did this miracle, he did that miracle, I prayed. And outside of your subjective reasoning, there's no evidence for any of that to happen. That's why people look at it and they laugh and they mock. Because subjectively, you can believe anything. But where's the objective evidence? There's a big conference going out on in a few weeks out on the West Coast about cessationism. A cessationist is a person that believes God has finished speaking The Bible's complete, and he's not working miracles anymore today. He isn't giving miraculous gifts. It's a thing that tells you that the charismatic movement's not accurate when they say God's still talking, God's still working, he's still doing miracles. You ask prayer and God move them out and that kind of stuff. And these people say, no, that's not true. And the fact is, in the scripture, God says the book's complete. God isn't going to talk to you anywhere in your life, anytime in the future, except through the Word of God. The book's complete. You're not writing any more Bible. You got every verse you need. You got it all translated in your language. You got a King James Bible. You got the whole thing. God's already spoken. You say, Lord, would you say something to me? I already have. And if he already has, where is it? It's in a book. It's in your language. It's in your lap. And you're asking for more. He said, no, that's enough. It's sufficient. It's complete. And he said, well, how do you get the information? That's what rightly dividing is about. That's why we labor in those issues constantly. That's why having an entertainment program here isn't enough. I want to have a couple hours a week with you. You need a lot more than that. Alex and I are trying to spur your interest in getting more of it on your own. If it was just having a jitterbug, what do you say about Brother Joe? He could cut a rug. That's the old way of saying he could dance, you know, if you're my age. But what good's that going to do you? You can go put the radio on and do that. What you need is some grounding in God's Word, and that's the goal of things. When I talked to you about depression, I did it in the context of Romans 12, which says not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but think soberly. Depression is an emotional state. But if you're going to understand emotions and being in an emotional state of despondence and depression and dejection, you have to understand where your emotions come from. Because your emotions will tell you they run your life, but they don't. Your emotions have no intellect. They don't have a thinking capacity. Your emotions believe anything you think. You tell it, and they respond to it. Your emotions are responders. They respond to the thinking in your mind. To understand your emotions, you have to understand the relationship of your mind to your emotions, your thinking to your emotions. Emotions are always predictable based on what you think. Now, what you do sometimes is you get in such a habit of thinking something, every time you see a stimulus, you think it. You see the stimulus, you think it, and all of a sudden, your emotions learn, when they see that, they're going to think this, and I'll do that, and I'll just skip the thinking. I know what they're going to think and go to it. And so sometimes your emotions become automatic, but they didn't come automatic until the habit of your thinking that way got them there. Did I say that too fast? No, okay. They're always based on the way you think. That's why medical treatment, drugs, psychotherapy are only temporary because they don't change the way you think. Now, understand something about medical treatment, that kind of, and medicine and so forth. That's your responsibility, not mine. For you to think how to do that, those are your decisions. Somebody says, well, should I seek counseling? Well, if you talk about psychotherapy, no. But there's a lot of counseling, discussing something with someone who has some wisdom and getting learning techniques and tools. Discussing the thing, psychotherapy is a conversation about a problem based on human viewpoint. And there are all kind of psychotherapeutic schools of thought and so forth that go all based on human viewpoint. Psycho, that's psuche, the study of your soul. You can't study a person's soul by looking at them because you can't see their soul. The only person that can tell you how your soul operates is God. He created it. And he tells you in his word. And I draw those circles all the time, spirit, soul, and body, how they interplay, how they work together. And when you understand it, then you understand how to influence your soul, how your flesh can influence your soul, and how your soul is designed to be lived through the light of the Word of God. There are formulas for that. But can I tell you, as you're looking at problems, that doesn't mean that... I was talking to someone some time ago, and they said, you know, Brother Rick, here's this thing I'm dealing with, and I go to bed every night quoting that verse of Scripture. And it doesn't seem to be helping. I said, well, let's talk about that verse of Scripture. What does it mean in this context? How does it work? Just quoting a verse doesn't give you an answer. It tells you how to find the answer. The details about how to deal with something, the tools you need to deal with that, that's another step. That's why I gave you, we went through, think about what we've been over the last 6 months, 6 or 8 weeks. We went through James chapter 1. There's a paradigm. There's a structure about how you get into sin. You find yourself into sin, whatever kind of sin it is. Maybe it's a mental sin, an emotional sin, a physical sin. Whatever it is, James chapter 1 says, here's what you do. First, second, third, fourth, and fifth. That's when it becomes sin. You don't have to wonder about it. So when you find yourself in sin, you can just go take James chapter 1, verse 15 to 18, and write them down, pattern your life, your behavior, and say, there's what I got to stop, because that's what led me into sin. Now, you don't need Jung, Freud, anybody else for that. God's Word gave you that. So what you do is you analyze yourself based upon what God's Word says. So here's a step that leads to choosing sin. We went through Romans 6. Here's a step that gets you out of sin. Well, you stop. What stops sin? The cross. That's what stops it. And Romans 6 gives you the details. It says you've got this specially designed way you sin. The body of sin. The way sin produces in your life. You sin differently than I do, and I sin differently than you do on a personal level. It'd be the same sin. We can all lie, but you lie your way, I lie my way. You understand what I'm talking about. And Romans 6 says, here's how you stop that. That's why we spent weeks going over Romans 6 over and over to analyze the parts of it. Genesis chapter 3. There's a paradigm. Not just how you get into sin, but the defense mechanisms that you have to avoid accountability for your sins. You remember going over that? Operation Fig Leaf, the avoidance, performance system, religion, the avoidance, hide, the blame shift. It's the woman you gave me, God, it's your fault. All the things to avoid accountability. You can't deal with something if you're not responsible for it. And your old sin nature has this mechanism to do all that. And so you have all these things in the Scripture that tell you how to deal with the problem. So he said, I need to have repentance. I need to change my mind, a new process of thinking. Well, 2 Corinthians chapter 7 tells you how to do that. You don't just take I need to do this and go get a religious idea. The Scripture gives you all these details about how to handle them. When I'm talking to you about these things, that's what I'm talking about. I'm not saying don't go get about your human viewpoint to do it. Get in God's Word and use some creativity that God gave you to take the truth that He gave you and apply it to the circumstances you're in. Okay? So when I said I'm your pastor, not your counselor, maybe I didn't tell you the truth. Maybe I said I'm your pastor. I just want you to have the counsel of God's Word, not human viewpoint. Are we okay with that? No? Well, argue with me later. Now, you know what a recommendation that is. Anyway, when we talked about the depression, and I'm going to use this because I went over this several weeks. This is the way life works. There's a formula. There's depression. There's discouragement. There's despondency. The levels of depression that come from just the I'm discouraged down to the slough of despond, Bunyan called it, the darkness. Paralyzed kind of thing. The way you get there, the CNS gang attacks you. You have an incident. You have an offense. You have something that happens. Circumstances and situations whack you. You immediately respond. You're created by God to respond to circumstances. You respond with anger or fear, the two motivating things. Fear is not a sin. Anger is not a sin. Be angry and sin not, Paul says. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Those are not sinful responses. They are designed into your makeup to cause you to take action, one toward, one away. So you have the offense, you respond. Now, the next question, I've got an offense plus a response. When you multiply that response by self-pity, it'll always produce depression. So if I'm depressed, I know what happened. I had an offense, I responded to it, and then I multiplied it by self-pity. Now, where does self-pity come from? We're going to do some psychology here. Study your soul. Write down, look with me, Proverbs chapter 13. Brother Rick said, I didn't say this. God said it. Now, you think, and think about what I'm saying to you now. When you're dealing with yourself or someone else, this is where you go. This is the steps that lead to depression, and this is the step that leads out of it. But I'll never get out of it unless I know I'm in the slough. So how did I get in the slough? I had an offense. I had a CNS gang came along. I responded to it. I'm motivated to do something. But my self-pity motivated me to do something that led to depression, to the darkness. Where did that come from? Proverbs 13, verse 10. You see that first word? Only. That means there's not going to be anything else. This is it. Only by pride cometh contention. But with the well-advised is wisdom. So where does contention come from in your life? Well, you just don't know what they did to me, Brother Rick. No, I don't. But what does that verse say, contention about what they did to you comes from you? Class got real quiet. So if you're going to deal with the depression, what have you got to deal with? You can't deal with it from the point of view of pride. But that's what you do. Why? Because that's what we are. We're sin. The middle letter of the word sin. How many times have you heard me say, what is the middle letter of the word sin? Look at the word pride. What's the middle letter of the word pride? And only by pride, only by sin, the sin of pride, comes contention. So you get in a fight with your neighbor, your wife, your spouse, your boss, whatever it is. If you're in a fight, you're in a contention, you know where your side of it came from. But you don't know what he did. I didn't ask anything of that. I just said, what did the verse say? So what I have to do is I have to back up and come right here because there's something else I could respond with that wouldn't cause the depression. But what causes the darkness is when I multiply it by the self-pity. Oh, pity me. And what that does is it puts you on a spiral that goes down, 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 all through the steps, all through the phases, to the depths of depression. We went over different people. There's a study in the bookstore, 6 different studies on depression. All of them start with a key Bible figure who is depressed. Depression is not anything common, uncommon to man. It's common. We all have it to some extent. Based on your personality, maybe how much it is, but we all have it. Major Bible characters, the Apostle Paul, for example, filled with depression. But when you see that, then you see the answers to it. And the answer is not to focus on yourself, not to focus on only by pride comes contention. I'm going to promote myself. But what you do is you swap the self-pity. You make a conscious choice. That's not how to think in everything by prayer and what? Thanksgiving. Let your request be known. You give thanksgiving for every. So whatever it is, 1 Thessalonians 5 tells me, for that in that I can be thankful. Now, we often say, in that you can be, in all things give thanks. And we say, we didn't say for all things, but Ephesians 5 says for all things. Well, you're not going to give thanks for it until you give thanks in it. There's a process there, a growing process. And I look at the process, I look at the difficulty, and I say, even in the midst of whatever the tragedy is, and I've thought about trying to rehearse for you some of the heartache, and I thought, well, you really don't need me to do that. Whether it's sickness, whether it's all kind of, just turn the news on and listen to the cruelty of the world, the cruelty that you can experience. And you look at it and you say, well, that's enough to discourage anybody. It's enough to depress anybody. How can I give thanks for that? You're not giving. In it, you can give thanks to God for His goodness. Philippians chapter 4, if you look at that. How should I think about the things, the CNS gang, when it comes along? Well, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse number 15, verse number 18, start in verse 16. Rejoice evermore. Woo! Well, can you rejoice in the Lord? No matter how bad things get, could you just sit down and say, you know, no matter how bad things are right now, this isn't the end of the game. What's the end of the game? Looking for that blessed hope and glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. You know what the end for you is? Oh, that will be glory for me, glory for me. That's the end for you. That's the reality of your future. So why would you judge everything by what's going on right now? Well, that's because you live in the moment. And you're thinking about how you're looking at it. You think of how you feel about it. And you get caught up in you. Verse 17, pray without ceasing. You know, if you talk to God about what's going on in your life, instead of begging Him to change everything and begging Him to do things He's not doing, and you know what He's doing today because you understand God's Word rightly divided, you know you're not Israel, you know you're not in the kingdom program, you know no back in all this other stuff. Everything in the Bible is not about you. Everything in the Bible is not what God's doing right now. But when you understand what He is doing, He's forming the church, the body of Christ. He's taking believers like you, putting you into His Son, giving you an identity, an eternal identity in His Son, blessing you with all spiritual blessings in heaven and place, make you complete in Christ. There's nothing God has for you that you don't already have. What do you think you're going to do today for God that's going to get Him to give you something you don't already have? He gave it already to you as a gift. We go off on a trip. My wife buys gifts for people. I never get anything, but... No, I do. I get a smile and a hug. Opportunity to give her some funds. But you know, when she brings it and gives it to somebody, she didn't want to pull out the billfold and say, here, can I pay? Let me pay you for it. She doesn't want that. You know what? You offend her if you do that. Because she loved you and she valued you and she wants to give you something out of appreciation for you. Not because you have to have it. Not even because you deserve it. Because she wants to give it to you. God gives you all spiritual blessings, and you're going to say, well, Lord, I'm just going to do it. I'm going to prove I deserve that. I mean, that thought ought to crack your skull. No. But see, that's what we do. We get the idea that we can still do something. Grace, go all in on grace and say, God gave it to you already. Just sit down and relax. And when you're in circumstances in life, talk to Him about what He's done, who you are in Him. Pray without ceasing. Now, how do you do that? Well, if prayer is, Father, we want to, how are you going to close your eyes and we can't pray when you're driving, can't pray when you're eating if you've got to close your eyes, bow your head. We used to go down to the old Pacific Garden Mission, I was telling my brother the other day, before you get into preach, you'd go into the prayer room. And the procedure in the prayer room was that everybody knelt down at the chair on a linoleum floor, and you prayed for about 20 minutes. And I'll be honest with you, I couldn't do it. I'd kneel down there, and in about 5 minutes, a grain of sand would get between my knee and the floor every time. And before you're there 5 minutes, that grain of sand's big as a softball, irritating the fire out of me. And I'd get up and sit in a chair. I can pray as good sitting in a chair as on my knees. But at the mission, you can't. You got to be spiritual and be on your knees. And so I was going to be the preacher, but I wasn't going to be the spiritual preacher because I wasn't praying on my knees. Well, that's not what prayer is, the posture in your prayer. Prayer is simply you talking to God. And you're talking to God about who He is, who He's made you, and what's He doing in you. And you say, Lord, what are you doing today? I'm making a saint. You say, look at all these circumstances. What are you doing in those circumstances? I'm helping you learn to grow, dude. What a shock. Because when you go through difficulties as a believer, what do? They educate you. You remember that verse about Jesus in Hebrews chapter 5? Hang on to Thessalonians. Look over Hebrews chapter 5. This is one of the most amazing verses in about the Savior. Hebrews 5, verse number 7. Who in the days of his flesh, think about that. When you see someone suffering, illness, deprivation, cruelty, and you see them crying bitter tears of sorrow and pain and agony and crying, why? Your Savior's not a God off up yonder. You know who he's called in the Bible? He's called a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. The God that created you came down and took your humanity and entered into your grief and your sorrow. And there's no sorrow, there's no pain, there's no heartache, there's no rejection that you feel, experience, or even know about that he hasn't already endured. He's completely acquainted with it. Who in the days of his flesh, when he offered up prayers and supplication with strong crying and tears, he knows what it is to be there in that moment of agony, crying to his Father. Unto him that was able to save him from death and was heard in that he feared, though he were a son, see that capital S? He was the son. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience. You see, when you're an adult, you can still learn some things. And when you go through things, it's so that you can learn obedience by the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, being made mature, being made grown up, he became the author of eternal salvation. And I read that and I think, wow, that's my Savior. That's God the Son. That's the one that stood on the precipice of nothing and spoke a universe into existence. And then he took on my humanity, your humanity, so he could learn how to apply his Father's will to the details of life in our flesh. He could go through what we go through, and he could figure out how to deal with it and apply the grace of his Father to the thinking. And he could mature, grow as a man. He gives you that privilege. So when you're going through whatever it is, remember him. Go through it like he goes through it. Now go back to 1 Thessalonians 5. Anytime I teach, I have an outline. I started writing these things out some years ago when Rachel was doing started doing the signing, and I found out that if I type it out, I can actually read it. Most of the time, I can't read my notes, so I don't. But my notes are like a battle plan in war. They're good until the first engagement. And I've never been able to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 down through something. I just can't. My mind doesn't work that way. 1 Thessalonians 5. So I apologize for bouncing back and forth. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 18. Now, after you've rejoiced in the Lord about everything that's going on, I'm just happy in the Lord no matter what circumstances. I'm talking to God about what's going on, what his word says, and how that applies to my life. In everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God concerning you, Christ Jesus. Someone wrote me and asked, said, does God have an individual personal will for my life? There it is. He doesn't have a life map where you have to go tomorrow. And the predestination Calvinism stuff is just pagan nonsense. But he has a will for your life. And there's one of them right there. In everything, give thanks. God has equipped me that in whatever the circumstances are, I can thank him for his grace in that circumstance. That not doesn't just get me through, but I can learn how to take the will of my Father and apply it to the details of my life so that I grow and other people get the benefit from it too. Now, go back to depression for a minute. Self-pity is a sin. So what do you do when you meet self-pity in your life? I'm in depression. I got the problem. Now let's back up and find out why I got there. I want to get the problem fixed. Then I need to go back and find the problem. You go out and get in your car, and you drive off, and it goes blah, 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 blah. You say, well, sounds like you got a transmission problem. No, you got a flat tire. Get the right problem. So what's the problem? Well, God says, you're there. You had a circumstance. You responded to it. And what multiplied it into depression was self-pity. So what I need to do? I need to defeat the self-pity. I need to take self-pity, pride, swap it for thanksgiving. You do it first, you say self-pity is a sin. Well, we looked at some instructions, paradigms about how to deal with sin. So what do? I say it's sin. I recognize what it is. I don't say, oh, I deserve this. I say, that thinking process is contrary to what God says. That's a wrong way to think. You get rid of that. I'm going to talk to you in the next 4 or 5 weeks about how to cleanse your conscience. I got thinking about, you need to understand how to cleanse your mind and your conscience. We'll talk about that. But right now, I just want you to see, that's what you do. You take it to the cross. The only place you're going to fix sin is Calvary. Romans 6 tells you how to do it. You're dead to sin. You're alive unto God. You put off one, you put on the other. That's not who I am. That's wrong. Get out. Here's who I am. I'm going to think like that. And then what do? You thank God in the experience that produced the self-pity. You say, right here in this, I have peace and joy because of who I am in Christ. And then the saying out in the world is you rinse and repeat. Because as soon as you do it and it comes up again, what do? Oh, I'm defeated. It came up again. No, you say, you know, I just got this terrible habit of doing this. And you go back and you go back to where the answer is. You go back to Romans 6, dead to sin, alive unto God. I'm free. I'm going to live the life I have in Christ. And again, you go back to Romans 6, think about what we studied. That's not just talking about a theological concept. That's talking about getting right down to the nitty-gritty of your practice in your life and the habits in your mind and saying, that one, dead, out. And you deny ungodliness and worldly. You deal with yourself by God's grace the way God's dealt with you. And you put that away. And you put in its place. If you don't put something in its place, it'll come back. You say, well, how do you do that? Go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 7. We went through those verses about the steps about doing it. And you take what the verses say and you do it. You practice what the verse says. And you know what? They work because they are life. They're in your Bible to tell you how to do these things because God knows you'll never figure it out yourself. But His grace has planned it for you. Now, the reason that you have suffering to start with, come with me to Romans chapter 8 real quick. There are three reasons for suffering. When you look at the world and you see all the misery and you see the suffering, you see the outrages of things that go on, they come from three things. One, there is what I call undeserved suffering. That's Romans 8. Two, there is choose sin, choose suffering. Whatsoever you sow, you're going to reap. And if you sow sin, you're going to reap suffering. So a lot of what happens in your life is just your bad choices. Third one is, yea, all they that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. You're going to take it in the neck for being a believer if you let anybody know you are. So you look at your life, you look at the world around you, and it comes from one of those three things. Most of them come in the world, Romans 8, verse 22. For we know, now you know this by the Scripture and you know this by experience. We know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but we also, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. Being a believer doesn't stop you from experiencing the groaning of creation. Verse 18, he says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall." There is a present time suffering that is happening in the world because God, instead of sending His Son back in the first century to establish the kingdom and take away the curse of creation and establish His kingdom, He changed the dispensation, changed the program, interrupted the prophetic program, put in grace, where he's forming the body of Christ, where he's not reclaiming the planet yet. He will one day, but he's not doing it now. He's reclaiming a group of people, a spiritual body of people, the church, the body of Christ, going to use in the heavenly places. You understand that. When you understand that, now you know why he hasn't intervened to stop it all. But where did it come from? It came from a fallen creation. In Genesis 1, God created everything. He says, it's good. It's working perfectly. He didn't create a creation with problems. He created a creation without problems. The difficulty was he put a man and a woman in it. And he gave them a free will. You're not a puppet. You're not a robot. He invites you to have life like he has. No other creature that God created did he give free will, volition to. He didn't give it to the animals. I mentioned we were in Colorado Springs in the airport, and right next to the men's bathroom, there's a pet bathroom. First one I ever saw. Now, when I got to Dallas-Fort Worth, people told me there's a bunch of them in Dallas-Fort Worth. I didn't have time to look them up. And yes, they did. They didn't have a fire plug, but they had a pole. And they had a turf for the dog. You know, how are you going to tell a dog to go, you know, go do his business? Well, you put a pole up. And, you know, they got them for the dogs and the cats and the birds and whatever's in there in the airport. And the animals, too. But you, creation, all of creation, he made one person with life like he had. Volition, the ability to choose. And God said, I'm not going to have a relationship with you like with all the animals. I'm going to give you the ability to choose to love me because I love you. And he gave man the ability to choose. But if he gave him the opportunity and the choice to love him, he had to give him the choice not to love him. And man chose to rebel. He had some influence about that and so forth. But with the fall of man, sin entered into man's world and death by sin. And the curse fell upon all creation. And the explanation for the why the suffering in the world is there is the fall, the broken creation that we live in. You live in a fallen, broken world. Jesus said it, John 16, verse number 13, the Lord himself, he understood the world we live in. Luke 16, verse 33, these things have I spoken unto you, he's talking to his apostles, the night before he died, that in me you might have peace. Peace is a wonderful thing. Peace is the opposite of turmoil. Peace is that relaxed mental attitude that Paul talks about in Philippians 4. Be careful for nothing, but in all things by prayer and supplication let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God that passes all understanding. Better than understanding why. Keep your heart. Paul says, now the God of hope fill you with joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. That relax, but I can just relax in all of this. The turmoil is gone. I'm trusting the Creator. I'm trusting the one that loves me. In spite of what the in spite of what the Satanist gang says, in spite of what my pride says about I don't deserve it, I know who I am in Christ. In me, you might have peace. In the world, you shall have tribulation. But be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. These dudes are fixing to go into the real great tribulation. They're going to see stuff you hadn't even thought about seeing. He said, in the world, because the world's broken and will be broken until he comes back and fixes it. So when you understand that, come with me back to Romans chapter 5. When you understand what's going on, listen, the key to all of this is that God's grace is ministered to you through the cross work of Christ, and then it's ministered by you to others. God's grace is ministered to you. Look at Romans 5, verse number 3. I'll start in verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. You want peace? That's where you have it. You have peace with God. You have it through Christ. That's what the cross does. By whom also we have access by faith into this grace when we stand. You have a union with Christ, identified with Him, one with Him. Now you can have communion with Him. That's your experience. You can bring Him into your experience and have access to this grace, to your standing. Bring it into your daily life. And rejoice in hope of the glory of God. What's going on now isn't the end. Poverty, pain, difficulties, tragedy, heartache. It isn't the end. You've got a hope. And not only so, but we also glory in tribulation also. Now, that's a big one. Now I can look at the problems I'm having now and I can say there's something here that's of benefit. Knowing, you got to get the knowing. If you don't know this, as a pastor, I'm trying to give you knowledge and understanding. This is what I want you to know. That tribulation works patience. The difficulties that come into your life are not come there to punish you for what you've done or haven't done. The difficulties that come into your life don't come because of some attitude that God has, He's against you, because He's never against you. He's always for you. You can't make God not love you. Think about that. You can't sin enough to make God not love you. Verse 21, he says, where grace abound, where sin abound, grace has much more abound. I know preachers tell you you can, but God tells you you can't. And when you sit down, look yourself in the mirror, look God in the face, and say, thank you. You can relax and quit trying to prove you're worthy of something when you're not. You can't. When it dawned on me, I just can't out-sin Him. I can't sin enough to make Him mad with me, because the cross took care of all of that. Now, I just need to cleanse my own heart from that, the thinking process. Knowing that tribulation, whether it comes from the undeserved suffering of sin in the broken world, whether it comes because I'm stupid and dumb, make bad choices, or if it comes from I've been godly and Christ, whatever it comes from, it's designed to work, to produce something in your soul. And it works patience. Patience is you just stick with the book, stick with the truth, stay with what God says. The tribulation teaches you remember what it said about Jesus? He learned obedience through the things He suffered. He goes through these things and he sees them and he says, you know, what my Father says is what's right, no matter what the other is. It works patience. And patience works. Experience. Now I've got some skill at handling. Look, I've been through that. You're going to go through it? Let me tell you about it. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 1. So all of a sudden, when I'm going through something, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, and I'm having the difficulty, and I'm seeing the problems, and I'm experiencing the pain, and I realize this tribulation isn't here because God doesn't love me. It's here because He does love me. In all of this, He does love me. And there's something for me to learn in this. I can stick with His Word. I can be patient with His Word because it's going to give me some experience that I can share with others. So now it isn't all about me. Now when it's self-pity, who's it all about? But now it's not all about me. I'm going through it. But you know, there's something bigger than me here. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3, blessed be the God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, the God of all comfort. Don't you love that? You want comfort? You're not going to get it from a bottle of Sigram 7. It might blanket out for a half an hour or a day or two, but when you wake up, you're going to have the headache, the heartache, and the empty wallet to deal with. But here's the God of real comfort, all comfort, who comforteth us in all our tribulation. Now see that next word, that. Why did God comfort me? Well, I needed it. And I wanted it. But he's got something bigger than me. There's something bigger than you in all of this. That, purpose or intent, we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith ourselves were comforted of God. Now all of a sudden I've gotten some comfort from God that I can go share with other people. I know where they are. Been there, done that. Here's how God comforts. And I'll have some wisdom to minister. And all of a sudden, it isn't just that God ministered to me, but now he's equipped me that he can minister by me. I get it from him so I can give it to others. And it makes me, getting it, have a bigger picture. Because it's not just me lying here. It's God working in me, equipping me to minister to others. And I think, wow, that's so fantastic. Now, I know what people say. They say, well, you know, I can't see it. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, just real quick. Every time somebody says, I can't see it, I know God can see it, but I can't see it. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7. These two verses are so, there's so much a heart of grace. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. Now that didn't mean a spooky kind of a thing you can't understand. He defines it, comma, even the hidden wisdom, which God ordained before the world in our glory. Back before the world began, God had a plan to form the church, the body of Christ. He didn't tell anybody about it. It's the whole basis of right dividing the word. If you're going to understand God's word, you've got to get this. There's that which is spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began. Genesis 1 all the way to the book of Acts. Peter. That which is spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets. Then there's another program which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest through the ministry given to Paul. Amen. A 6-year-old kid that's blind in one eye and can't see out of the other can get that. I'm not supposed to say it that way. That's offensive. I apologize. A 6-year-old kid that flunked kindergarten can get that. If you can't, I just told you your intellectual level. So there's a plan God had. He knew what he was going to do. But he didn't tell anybody. Why? Which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they wouldn't have crucified the Lord of glory. God knew that if he told Satan about this, he wouldn't crucify Christ. He kept it to himself. You're going through some things right now, and you say, why, God? And God says, just wait, I'll tell you later. You got that? So quit moaning and groaning about, I don't understand. You understand what you need to understand. You understand his grace. And you understand his the comfort and the assurance, the planning that he gives you there. And you might not be able to figure it all out at the moment, but the wisdom of God knows the plan. So rather than denying God's existence or his goodness or his wisdom, this gives the door of faith to rest in. And you can read the clues in the Word of God and have confidence in it. Just a few days ago, I had the opportunity to talk to a couple, came to a meeting, and they said, we were here about 3 years ago, and our marriage was on the rocks. Our lives were devastated. We hurt. We were angry. God didn't care about us. He didn't hear about us. We came to the place we didn't even believe God existed. The only reason we stayed together is we had kids, and the man told me, he said, I carried a gun in my car, and I couldn't decide I'm going to shoot my wife, I'm going to shoot myself. I can't live this way any longer. And the only reason I didn't was because of the kids. But we were just miserable. I said, well, what changed everything? A question. Do you believe that God raised Jesus from the dead? I mean, you really believe that? He said, I looked at my wife and we looked at it. We said, yeah, we believe that. And he said, you're telling me that you believe God could take a dead man and raise him from the grave and he can't heal your marriage? The question wasn't could God do it, whether are you willing to let him? And he said, that clicked in our mind. And we made a choice. We'll let God be God. And he said, he transformed our lives. When we first moved to Chicago, the old North Shore downtown, the old church building, we lived down in Uptown. There was a brother in the church there, J.R. Burge. You guys remember Mr. Burge? He was maybe 5'2", weighed about 80 pounds. He's laying in the bed, couldn't get out of bed. When I knew him, he could barely lift his head off the pillow. But he loved the Lord. He loved the message of grace, and I'd go see him occasionally. Franklin Anderson, every Sunday, would go to Mr. Burge's. He was in the Masonic Hospital. Whatever the unit was that kept the people indigent like that. And Franklin would go there and play a cassette recorder tape of the morning preaching. Go every Sunday afternoon. He took him a tape recorder, and the first day was there, Mr. Burge told me, said, the orderly stole it. And I couldn't even raise a hand to stop him. So Franklin got another cassette, took it, and listened to it. And Mr. Burge would listen to two studies every Sunday afternoon. He couldn't get out of the bed. He laid there, and he would ask, he said, why does the Lord just let me linger like this? Why does the Lord just let me linger like this? And one day Franklin told me, he says, you know, Mr. Burge would like for you to come and see him. He'd been laying in that bed for 4 years. And he couldn't get out. But he listened to Franklin, those tapes every week. And I went to see him. It was the first time I had seen him. And I went into the room and I said, Mr. Burge, Brother Burge. He looked up at me, little eyes, pale. And I said, I'm Pastor Jordan. He said, I know I can tell your voice. And he said, I've been listening to the messages. And it's just like J.C. has come back. And I went weak at the knees and literally sat down. Now what that meant to me and to him, that you probably wouldn't understand, he had been in the ministry at North Shore Church for decades. Franklin Anderson, these people have been there forever. 20 years before J.C. O'Hare was their pastor. And had been their pastor for 40 years, the better part of it in their lives. And then he wasn't there for those times. And then Franklin would take him, and when he says to a young 35-year-old preacher, it's like J.C.'s back. That took the wind out of my sails. I sat down. Because here's a brother who could know what J.C. O'Hare was like, saying to me, you remind me of him. And I literally sat there, I thought, wow. My thought about it was, what a horrible challenge that is to live up to, ministry-wise. But Mr. Burge, not too long after that, went to be with the Lord. But in his suffering, he had a hope, and he had an understanding, had some doctrine, some truth that held his life. A man came into the ministry there, life full of drugs, pornography, he's addicted to all these things, fill his every thought. He got saved. Mike Riddell, if you remember Mike, led him to the Lord. I said, Pete, how'd you get saved? He said, I got saved sitting on a park bench drinking a bottle of wine with this guy. And Mike introduced him to the Lord. And as he began to learn God's word, it began to transform his life. And instead of having the drugs and the pornography filling his every thought, he changed it with the gospel of the grace of God. There's a lady across the street, young girl, about 24 years old. Her mom and dad, she'd gone to Sunday school at the church there on Neva. Her mom and dad were Catholics, but they sent her over there because they wanted to, her mom came over one day after in Sunday afternoon. She said, would you come and see my daughter? And she was a beautiful young Italian girl, had a beautiful Italian name, but she was a wreck. And she'd been wrecked. Her complexion was all scaly and her hands were all withered up. And she'd do nothing but wash her hands. She said, I'm dirty. I can't get clean. And she's got these compulsive thoughts. And I'm sitting there talking to her. And I'm thinking, what do you do? And I'll tell you what I did. I said, you know, sugar, you're right. You are dirty. The Bible says your heart's deceitful, desperately wicked. That's why you have a Savior. And it's your Savior that cleans you. Let's read Romans 3. I literally read Romans 3. This is all the things. What's this about your throat, about your mouth? That's who you are in yourself, but here's who God made you. Here's who you are in Christ. You're not perfect. Quit trying to be. But God commended his love to you, and while you're yet a sinner, Christ died for you. And you can't stop him from loving you. Amen. And she looked at me like I'd lost my mind. But after talking with her a little bit, over a period of a couple of weeks, she began to get it. She began to see it. And all of a sudden, the darkness began. But you know what took the darkness away? Was the truth. I quit. Her mom and them were trying to, you know, manipulate around. I said, no, let's tell the truth here. You know what? You are a sinner. If you want to make all these bad things about yourself, you probably know more about yourself than I do. But I know the answer. The answer is in my Savior. So let's focus on that. Let's put your mind on that. And when she relaxed and quit trying to win God's love, quit trying to prove that she needed his love and rested in his love, it changed her life. Can I tell you, that's what I'm, the whole purpose for me in all this, for you. Just let God's grace grow you up. Deal with your suffering, deal with your stuff yourself. If you need help with it, you've got brothers and sisters in Christ around you to help you. And stand as a testimony to not only the existence of God, but the power of his word and his life to transform us in the demonstrations of the reality of his presence. That's available to all that trust him. That's who we need to be. No, that's who we are. So let's just be who we are. And appreciate it and live for his glory. And find the answer at the foot of the cross and the door of an open tomb. So when I'm talking to you about the grace life, I'm not trying to give a bunch of instructions, a list of do's and don'ts. You got to figure that out. But I want to show you how you make those choices and let it be God's grace that does it. So I commend the grace of God to you in all the things. And don't forget that when you get grace, it gives you the capacity to have it for others. Father, we thank you tonight for your love, this morning for your love and your grace. And I pray that we take these things to heart, understand them for what they are as the truth of your word, and then see your life live through us for your glory. May we be conscious of one another, the opportunity that we have to be an encouragement to one another, and the victory that can be ours because of your grace. In Christ's name, amen.